we just had this whole like existential crisis if we should put that intro music in our podcast because that's a song from Mulan. And so it's very possible that Disney is going to come after us and shut down this podcast before it even gets started because we are already, Crystal, infringing on copyright. Mm. So what a way to begin.
Mm-hmm. Good. Taking risks.
So I'm Sarah.
I'm Crystal.
And we talked, right? So we talked and we talk all the time about our perspective, about what's happening in the world. And we felt like we have a moral obligation and a sense of duty to share our perspective about what's happening in the world, especially after what we lived through in 2020. And we wanted to start this podcast series talking to each other, you know, almost sort of like we're literally at my kitchen table right now. And the kinds of conversations that we have around my kitchen table, we thought it was time to share it with the world.
Mm-hmm. Let's do it.
Let's do it. Mm-hmm. Are you ready?
We're ready.
Yeah, you know, today is like the second day of 2021. And, you know, we've been in a deeply reflective place about how 2020 was such a year that the analogy that we've been using is that it shook the bottle. Right. So for the entire world, it's like we all were like in this bottle, like we're all molecules inside some body of water inside of a bottle. And it just like a soda, right? Like it just got shaken and now it's super fizzy and all these molecules are bumping into each other and we're bumping up against the sides and we all are dizzy and have vertigo. And, you know, that 2020 was really the year of shake the bottle. And Crystal and I have been talking about how, you know, through those of you who know us, right, and have been following us on social media for a couple of years or, you know, have been at community events with us, probably have noticed that we've been a bit more quiet this year, both of us, mm-hmm. for our own personal reasons and, you know, for me also with a bit of what was happening in the world. And we decided that now was the time that the voices need to come out, that it's very, very important. But we wanted to start off by talking a little bit about why, you know, we'll talk about Shake the Bottle a little bit more later, but about why we made this podcast and what really our intention was as it takes legs and takes root. Mm-hmm. There's that great Gandhi quote where he says, you know, be the change you want to see in the world. And what I've been hearing echoing in the, you know, in the depths of my own subconscious is about, you know, be the voice that you want to hear in the world, right? Be the voice that you want to hear in the world. And that's really our intention. And what we witness as what's lacking in the world, we want to offer.
Yeah. Yeah. Especially empathy. Mm-hmm. All around.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, so Crystal and I both share a similar perspective that as, you know, we look out into the world, I'm going to speak for you, so, you know, let me know if this doesn't ring true for you, but that we both witness what we can really only describe as a shadow government, right? That there is a shadow government, illicit forces at all levels of government and really the powers that be. And so there are a number of people who we follow and listen to, podcasts and authors and thought leaders on the subject who talk about the shadow government. But what we found is that a lot of their voices are really negative and really lacking empathy. Like they'll call, you know, Hillary Clinton, Killery, right? Or Kill Gates. And it's like, ugh, like, that's just so it almost gives them more power, mm-hmm. right? It gives Killery, like, you're giving her more power than she has, or Kill Gates, it's, you know, or people, you know, that we love and follow, you know, whose ideas we love will just sort of spew on about these psychopaths and just use really aggressive tone and language. And we don't necessarily disagree with what they're saying and the truth that they found, but that their voices are just so harsh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What we've also found is that then, you know, so, and then we find these other voices that are just really kind and empathetic. Like, I love Brené Brown.
Mm-hmm.
And Brené Brown is beautiful and wonderful. I love her entire body of work, as you do too.
Yeah.
But Brene Brown ain't talking about the New World Order.
None of them are.
No.
Mm-mm.
You know, so these beautiful, empathetic thought leaders who talk about boundaries and compassion and love, they're not talking about the New World Order. So how do you talk about the New World Order and illicit happenings and mind control and propaganda in an empathetic and kind way?
Yes, and that's why we're here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we're here. We were just like joking around that we're like, especially with that intro music, we're like weaving through the jungle, like, you know, past all of the trees and everything. And we're like, okay, like this feels, I don't know, Crystal, I feel like we should talk about this first, right? Where it's like, you know, we've been saying this over the last couple of days of, as we've been imagining this podcast, where it's like, it is part of our destiny to speak the truth and in this kind and compassionate and empathetic way, right? Mm-hmm. That it's our destiny and it's our birthright. And it's in some ways, you know, without sounding too much like a martyr, like it's our birthright and it's our duty. Mm-hmm. It's our duty to God. It's our duty to the earth. It's the duty to our children that we communicate in this way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Especially, you know, for me, and I know Sarah, our, you know, at least the past few years studying nonviolent communication, studying a different type of communication that I haven't been seeing in the world, and learning how to talk to people in a different way. And yeah, this has all been leading up to this moment right here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like learning how to communicate with the people in our lives in a compassionate way and to create communities from that place that are truly all-inclusive. Yeah. And but then also we've been doing research and studying over the last, you know, for me, decade, I think about the same for you, about what really is this matrix that we live in? What really is the banking system? What really is Hollywood, you know, and who controls the media and the news? And so it's like these two massive forces, you know, of our, you know, of values that are important to both of us, right? Of seeking the truth. Right? Like, who created the education system? Mm-hmm. Somebody who I love and admire, Jeff Berwick, he started the Dollar Vigilante. He was like, don't call it government schools, right? He was call it government propaganda, call it internment camps, right? So it's like, who created these education systems? It's across the board, right? So this value that we have about seeking truth, what is the matrix and what is it founded upon? And then also, you know, our value of compassion and empathy, these two giant values and forces in our own personal lives have really, you know, married each other within each other. And now is the time. Mm-hmm. Now is the time more than ever.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because what the fuck happened in 2020?
That was good.
Thank you. Thank you.
What happened?
What happened? Or even more accurately, right? So it's like that's our question for today, right? Like maybe that's the title of this episode, is what the bleep happened in 2020, right? Mm-hmm. But really maybe we could talk a little bit, you know, more about why we feel it's this duty that we have to share this information with the world and to share our perspective. And we were talking earlier today, and I'll say this, right? It's like God, the universe, the divine, whatever you want to call that, gave me this blueprint, right? Gave me a blueprint, gave me an astrological blueprint, gave me the archetype of the warrior in my astrological chart, made me a Scorpio, gave me the privileges that I've had as a white woman in Connecticut, right? I was given this blueprint, and now it's like God is asking this question, is like, what are you going to do with it? I gave you these privileges. I gave you this blueprint. I gave you this astrological chart. You know, you have Cancer in your first house and Saturn is in your seventh house, right? And all of these, you know, astrological musings and whatever else it is that makes me, right? These systems and personality assessments. Like, here's your blueprint. Now, what are you going to do with it?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right. And so I feel this very strong sense of duty where it's like, I didn't go through what I've gone through in my life, right? Through then my chosen experiences and collaboration with the divine. I didn't go through what I went through. I wasn't given the beauty of the blueprint that I was given to just stay silent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. So then it sort of starts to beg the question, like, why do we feel this compulsion to tell the truth in an empathetic way?
Yeah. Yeah, and even more so in 2020 for me, it was almost like, how can I walk through this year with more empathy in my actions? And so that's where I kind of took it was, you know, building and connecting the people who had similar thoughts to me and were looking for that. Mm-hmm. So this for me is like getting bigger, talking louder, going wider.
Yeah, and why now, right? Like, so, if, you know, maybe we could dive a little bit into why now, right? Like, why were we more silent in 2020? Whereas here it is, it's the second day of 2021, and we're like, we have to make a podcast.
We have news.
Right.
Of the times.
News of the times. Conversation of the times. Let's put Mulan fight music at the beginning, right? Like, why now, oh Crystal? Why are we doing this now? Tell me.
It's like you can only go so long. It's like you can only go so long without being a bigger voice. At least that's where I've come from in my life. Like, there are times, you know, to go under, figure some things out, you know, like the bottle being shaken in 2020. And I think now is the time to open up with each other in a different way of communicating and, yeah, seeing how others feel.
It's almost like there's a, Maya Angelou has a great quote, and she's like, I'm going to butcher it a little bit, but she says something along the lines of, like, there's nothing worse than bearing an untold story in your soul, right? There's nothing worse than bearing an untold story in your soul. And however we then share that, whether it's through written word or a conversational podcast with a friend or a piece of art, like whatever it might be, it's, you know, we all know that feeling, right? I remember it when I was younger, and I've always been some sort of an artist, you know, writing for me has always been really important. And I remember being in such agony, knowing that I had a story to tell, and it would literally eat me away at not having the skill or the stamina or whatever at that time in my life to be able to express it. And so I hear you where it's like, again, it comes, I keep coming back to this language where it's like a sense of duty, right? Because it's a duty to yourself. Because like you're saying, you can only go so long without telling what's happening inside of you.
Yeah. Yeah. And I see, like, right now, the magic of you and I coming together, like, what? Being really good friends for, like, the last couple years?
Yeah.
That's it. And, but we have this, I don't even know, unspoken, deep connection, bond, where we can literally talk about anything. Anything. Sarah's the one I go to talk about anything. So us coming together and talking about everything is everything.
Yeah, and then as time goes on, we're really excited to bring our friends and the other people who we talk with. You know, where we're sitting at the kitchen table, we have a third seat that no one is sitting in. We're like, it's waiting for our friends.
An open seat.
Yeah, because it is. And it's, you know, you're making me think of something else too. A couple things. But one of the things that you're making me think of is that, you know, when I look back on like the last 10 years of my life, you know, I just turned 30 like a month ago. If I look back on the last 10 years of my life, you know, I've been quiet about what I perceive as injustices in the world. I've been quiet about the New World Order and the shadow government and, you know, talking about what I perceive to be false flag events and things that when I look at the world is has an element of truth for me. I'll put this as a big disclaimer, right? We talk about this a lot, and I talk about this with some of our other friends too, that, You know, one of the other problems that we have with other conspiracy voices, if we want to use that mm-hmm. language, right, is that, you know, in the conspiracy world, people can get so like, this is the truth about 9/11, right? That it's an inside job and blah, blah, blah. And it's like, and if you don't see that, then you're an idiot, right? And when I look at it, here's what I know to be true, right? I'm like, okay, what I know is that what the mainstream media told me was a lie. But I don't know. I'm not here to pretend like I understand the full truth, right? At the same time. And so a lot of times in these more conspiracy realms, it's like, okay, like here's what did happen on 9/11. It's like there's so much more than we don't understand. What I do know is that what the mainstream media and the government and my history books told me, I know that it's full of lies, and at the very least, it's not the full truth. But I'm not here to pretend like what I know is the full truth either, right? It's like, okay, it was an inside job by the American government. I'm like, what is even America, right? Like, what is even the earth? Like, I'm pretty sure we live in a poor simulation. And we're like, there's these underground cities, and I hear about underground cities, and I'm like, somebody describe, like, what are the underground cities? And I'm like, that sounds a lot like what we're living in. And I'm like, I think we might be underground, you know? So it's like, I'm not here to pretend like I truly know anything. But what I do know is that what I've been told by the powers that be is certainly not the full truth, and is has a lot of lies in it. So, you know, when I look at over the last 10 years, I've been really quiet around, you know, what I perceive to be injustices being perpetrated by New World Order, powers that be, however we want to describe that, shadow government. I've been really quiet for fear of being socially ostracized.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because the second you know, 9/11 is such a, you know, divisive event. And of course it should be, you know, lives were lost. It was traumatic for really, you know, so many people, myself included. I was 11, right? It was so traumatic and such an emotional experience that the second you start to poke holes in the story that the media told, you're a threat.
Mm-hmm.
Or if I start talking about how, you know, I think that masks might be a way to muzzle us, and then I think that part of what we've been told about masks and the numbers that are coming out right now about coronavirus, I think are fabricated, right? That's not to say that I don't have empathy, right? If one of your family members has gotten coronavirus or gotten sick or, God forbid, died from it, like, it doesn't matter if the numbers have been inflated or not. Like, you're in a time of grieving. Your family member has died or gotten sick, and that's just, you know, blessings to you, because it doesn't matter how many people died, your person did, right? But as soon as I start to use this critical lens and start to say, but this isn't all adding up, it's like getting dragged through the streets, right? Getting dragged on the internet. Like, you know, people say you're wearing a tinfoil hat, like this, you know, that you're some woo-woo out there, you know, and it's like, I'm just hypothesizing and witnessing and seeing some things that are not being perpetrated by the mainstream media, or, you know, by the brainwashing propaganda that is so apparent to me. And I've witnessed this in my own life with other family members who have tried to poke holes in the mainstream media stories, and those family members have been socially ostracized.
Mm-hmm.
So even now, I feel a little bit of fear, right? Like, here I am saying, like, hey, let's poke some holes in the coronavirus story, the coronavirus narrative. It doesn't fucking add up, right? Mm-hmm. Let's poke some holes in 9/11. Let's poke some holes in the banking system. Let's poke some holes. We all know that some shit is fucked up, right? Like, we all know that. But as soon as you start to actually dig and poke holes, it becomes a threat. And I think that's on purpose too.
Yes, yes. It all is on purpose. All of it. Yeah, it's like this great, I don't even know, like the strings are being pulled in every which way. And it doesn't, it just, it's hard. It doesn't matter, but it does. And I think it's great that we're talking about our feelings with that too, and the fears for talking out loud. I mean, for me, I've been poking holes in the public school system for a decade now, and that's what probably people know me for, is homeschooling. But because of my focus on homeschooling, all of this other stuff kind of gets put on the wayside and is usually private talkings because I'm focused in another area. So yeah, for me, this is good.
Yeah.
This is good.
It is good.
Mm-hmm.
It's important. And you're reminding me that what we were talking about earlier today, where it's like, in the world that we live in, it's like one of our friends always says this. It's like, if you don't have, like, you know, a double blind study, right? Like about masks or whatever. Like if we just use that example, we could use anything, right? But if you don't have like a scientific double blind study, then what you're saying is just complete garbage, right? And we live in a society where science is God, right? Like, let's not pretend like we don't still somehow live in a religious oligarchy. It's just been replaced by science and the dogma of science.
Science.
And let's not forget, like, just like how the word of Christ was manipulated to fit the needs of the empire, the truth of science is being manipulated to meet the needs of the empire.
Oh my God.
Oh my God.
That's a big thought.
That's a big thought.
Because
what did I just say?
Exactly. Yes. It's like, here is the word of Christ.
Right.
Here it is.
Right.
Have it. Eat it. Be it. You know, like, nothing else.
Mm-hmm.
Or you're ostracized.
Mm-hmm.
Here's science. Mm-hmm. Here's all the facts. And who cares if it's switching day to day? Mm. I say this one day and then I say this the other day. It's still science. Eat it. Okay, that's right.
Yeah, right? It's not the body of Christ. It's the body of science.
Yeah.
Right? Here's your GMO. Here's your GMO cracker. Yeah.
How quickly it has switched
from
one extreme to the other. Because both of these are good.
Mm.
But when it's pushed to the extreme, nothing in extreme is good.
And I think it has an agenda, right? So like when the word of Christ was taken and manipulated, right?
Yes.
Like the word of Christ was taken and manipulated to further the needs of the empire. And, you know, if it's manipulated and it has an agenda. And I think the same thing is being done with science.
Yes.
And so it's like if you don't have a double blind study to prove whatever, then you're full of hogwash.
Mm-hmm.
One of our friends was saying where it's like, she, you know, if we're talking about vaccines, right? And, you know, Crystal and I, we're both about your right to choose, right? Like that's really where we both stand with it. And we both are personally against vaccinations, but we're all about everyone's right to choose. So, you know, one of our friends was saying, talking about vaccines in particular, and you know, she's a very spiritually minded body worker, like an intuitive body worker. And, you know, and again, it's all about your right to choose. But when she looks at the world of vaccinations and she sees these posts that are coming out on social media and everyone's got this big smile on their face and this big long post about how glad they are to have this COVID vaccine, she has a gut, visceral reaction in her body that says no.
Mm-hmm.
Which is fine for her, right? She's not going to get the vaccine, but it's difficult because she has family members, and one of her family members has her sister has Down syndrome, and so another family member has power of attorney over this sister, and so her sister doesn't actually get to make her own choice about whether she gets the vaccine or not. So our friend is really struggling because she has nothing more than a gut feeling that the vaccine is a no for her. But then that also extends for her to her sister. And she's like, God, like, please, no, like, don't give this to my sister. You know, she's health compromised and all she has is her gut feeling. But because she doesn't have a triple blind study and, you know, reputable, you know, scientific fact that it's just a gut feeling. And so because of that, her family, who worships science, is not going to take her seriously.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that you and I both see as being lost in our world, too, of like that somehow in our world, these gut instinctive, instinctual feelings, like our motherly, maternal instincts, right, are being posited as wrong and generating. When we were growing up, right, we were not taught how to listen mm-hmm. to our own intuition, how to listen to our own gut instinct.
That was thrown out the door, and it was do as I tell you to do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do as I tell you to do.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Right. So it's like, you know, we live in this world where gut instincts are not valid.
Mm-hmm.
But gut instincts are the oldest wisdom that we have.
It's how we survive. It's how are we you survive. Hungry?
Yeah.
Your body right. tells you.
Right.
So why wouldn't our body be able to have a feeling about something?
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Right. But if you don't have a triple blind study to back it up, then it's, you know, not that, you know, of course, like having, you know, facts and, you know, articles and whatever, like that's all great, but let's not lose the wisdom of our gut instincts. And that sort of brings me back to the idea around when I look at what's happened in 2020, it doesn't add up. My gut is from the beginning, from the first time I heard news about coronavirus, the first time it came into the news, my stomach dropped and I said, false flag agenda.
Mm.
And then I watched as the year went on and I watched...
A whole year.
A whole year. Yeah, like the first time that coronavirus was mentioned in Wuhan was December 2019. So it's like I've watched this whole year and I've watched my entire world change and everyone's world around me. And so from the beginning, I had that gut feeling. I was like, this smells like a false flag operation. This smells like bullshit. And then I watched the ordinances come and I watched the social pressure and I watched, you know, Dr. Fauci's, you know, statements change every other day. And I watched the mainstream media and I watched the propaganda and I feel like I just... watched it all, and my gut instinct was telling me, I was like, it doesn't add up that the small businesses and restaurant industry have been completely demolished, but Walmart and Target have stayed open. Amazon factories have stayed open.
Oh, and they're expanding.
And they're
Amazon factories are expanding.
Right. Mm. And small businesses, they're not even dying, they're dead.
Yeah.
They're dead. The yoga studios, the small restaurants, right? But don't worry. If you have a takeout window, you can drive right on up. No problem.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Or I look at how the airline industry got a multi-billion dollar bailout. Why the airline industry and not the restaurant industry who, you know, the government fucked over just as much?
Yeah.
And that is my gut telling me that there is something fishy here.
Mm-hmm.
Period.
Yeah.
And who am I not to trust that? That would be, again, a disservice to myself, to God, to the universe, to everyone that I hold dear in my heart, to all of humanity, to not listen to my gut and say, this doesn't add up, this smells like bullshit.
Mm-hmm. And we are allowed to have those thoughts. We are allowed to question anything and everything.
Right.
Why not 2020?
So let's talk about this.
Mm.
Let's talk about censorship.
Mm.
What have you seen?
Will this make it?
Oh my God. I really, like, you know we're doing a good job if they shadow ban us. Like,
oh,
that's
gosh.
The test. Like, we already are challenging Disney with our Mulan
right?
music.
I don't think they'll be listening to podcast. I don't know. That who knows?
Yo.
But, yeah. Yeah. So shadow banning happened to me on Instagram when... Yeah, we had this crazy experience at a grocery store.
Mm.
And my gut instinct picked up when we were picking out produce. I'm with my two children and I had a gut instinct to look up. And, you know, I saw this man, two men watching us, and I do a rendezvous in the grocery store. And realize that they are actually following us and watching us. So I grab my kids' hands and we walk to the checkout register. where then these two men walked to the furthest checkout register to see what we were doing and kept an eye on us. Anyways, everything was fine. I told the lady that we needed help getting to our car. Great, they walked us to our car, nothing happened. But when I told this story on Instagram, in my stories, the next week, I was not allowed to post any videos in my stories if I talked longer than 10 seconds. Mm. That was maddening. Mm. A story where I didn't even, like, you think about the keywords that they're listening to, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
COVID.
Mm.
Virus. Like, those mm-hmm. are the top ones that I'm thinking of. Mm-hmm. Nothing was in that, so...
Tracking, right? Like, human trafficking, mm-hmm. right? Which is super high up in the news a lot, and yeah. should be.
Yeah.
Yeah, that you're exposing how human trafficking works.
Yes.
Yeah.
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 So Instagram said, no, you cannot talk about this.
You can't talk about anything.
You can't talk about anything now for a week.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I watched it happen. So, like, you know, obviously, like, you know, I've known censorship, you know, has existed for a very long time, right? But I remember watching it happen. So, you know, disclaimer, I'm not a Trump supporter. I'm not a Biden supporter. I think that everyone is a deep state actor. It's all a stage. It's all a game. It's all a play, right? So, I'm not a Trump supporter. But I do believe in free speech. So, I remember watching around... the election, right? Just like 2 months ago. So I was watching the election happen, and I think it was on like Wednesday evening. Joe Biden was, the media announced that Joe Biden was the president-elect. And the following evening, so, you know, what had been happening previously, as I'm sure everyone can remember, right, was all of this talk about illegal votes. Well, we're in January now, and I don't know if some weird shit is going to be going on. Like, we've still got, like, another couple weeks before yeah. inauguration. Like, who knows what's going to happen, right? But, you know, around this time, Donald Trump was speaking about, you know, illegal votes. Now, I watched it happen. It was fascinating, right? So I watched Donald Trump give this talk about illegal votes, which, again, it's like, it's maddening, Crystal, because it's like, did everyone forget, like, George Bush stealing the election? Like, here's another question. Does anybody, like, honest question. This is an honest question. Yeah, and I feel like I've been awake to this, you know, since, you know, probably since George Bush's election when I was 10. Does anyone honestly believe that the American people choose the president?
Mm-hmm.
I know, you know, that's, I don't mean to sound that like, oh, if you believe that, like, you know, you're foolish, but it, like, to me, it's so painfully obvious, right? Like,
I think a lot of people know that,
yeah.
but there's not a good enough second option.
Mm-hmm.
Like, sure, independent, but mm-hmm. everyone's like, sure, I can vote independent, but nothing's gonna happen, so right. I might as well vote these two.
Right. Right.
So we need a third option.
We need a third. We need, I don't know.
Everything is going to crumble. Yeah. Like, it doesn't even, like, everything's yeah. going to be.
Yeah. yeah. It's the controlled demolition of the American empire, and there's nothing that we can do to stop it. We can yeah. just get to, it's like a tsunami coming, and all we can do is get to higher ground.
Yeah.
To literally quote, there's a couple of gentlemen who I love, who, you know, Charlie Robinson and Jeff Berwick, right? Charlie Robinson has a great podcast called Macro Aggressions. Jeff Berwick has a book with Charlie Robinson called The Controlled Demolition of the American Empire. Their whole platform is that there is nothing we can do to stop the demolition. It's a controlled demolition, right? But there's nothing that we can do to stop it. We can just get the word out to get to higher ground, like a tsunami is coming.
Yes.
So, you know, to me, it's painfully obvious that it's not an election, it's a selection, mm-hmm. right? It's a selection. I think that all votes, like, especially on the presidential level, like, I think that they just go into nowhere land, like the island of misfit toys and Rudolph yes. the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Like, they just go nowhere. Like, I don't even think they get counted, right? What do I know, right? That's just my speculation. But, so, you know... And there were also, you know, some videos coming out at this time, like, about things about illegal votes. Now, you know, I'm not saying that that didn't happen. Let's just say that, right? I'm not yeah. saying that that didn't happen. But I do think that all of that is also part of the grand staged play that's happening. So, you know, Donald Trump was pretty actively speaking the week of the election about illegal counting of votes. And he spoke ad nauseum about it, about, you know, these ballots that were getting dumped and whatever. Like, look into it for yourselves. Like, you know, I think Charlie Robinson on Macroaggressions has a, he has a couple of podcast episodes about it. I don't want to get into it now. But what Donald Trump was saying was stop counting illegal votes. And he, you know, there is some precedent for illegal voting. So that's all he was saying. Stop counting the illegal votes. And then I watched the mainstream media distort that and turn it into this soundbite of Donald Trump saying, stop counting the votes. And sort of like positing him as this, I'm not saying he's not deranged, but he's not deranged in the way I think people think he is, as this like deranged person saying, oh, well, by the number of votes that have already come in, I already won, so just stop counting votes. Like a moron, right? Yeah. Like, don't count all the votes. I've already won. We have, you know, 20% of the votes and I already won, so just stop counting now, right? Mm. Like, that's what they made it sound like he was saying. So the mainstream media has this soundbite of Donald Trump saying, stop counting votes. And then I literally watched in my news feed on Facebook this brainwashing of then people in my newsfeed, real people who I know, parroting back what the mainstream media had said, saying, you know, you idiot, Donald Trump, like every vote gets counted in every election from the beginning of time. And it's like, that's, did you actually watch what he said? Because that's not what he's saying. Mm-hmm. Okay, so, oh, it's also maddening, right? So, and then it became this whole like platform for like a couple of days, and like people were, you know, protesting, and they, the these signs were getting made where people said count every vote, and it's like, oh
my God,
right, like, hello.
Yeah.
So okay, back to the week of the, well, this, we're still in the week of the election. On Wednesday evening, I think my timeline could be wrong, but Wednesday evening, the media announces Joe Biden as the president-elect. On Thursday evening, okay, ABC, CBS, NBC, all the major, Fox, all the major news networks are casting Donald Trump addressing the nation. Now, this is the president of the United States giving a press conference, right? He's still the president. Even, you know, Joe Biden is the president-elect. Donald Trump is still the president. He's speaking to the American people. And he starts talking again about stop counting illegal votes. He's talking about this. ABC, CBS, and NBC turned off their cameras and cut back to their news anchors and started saying, what Donald Trump is saying is dangerous. We don't support it. And so we are not going to broadcast what he's saying. I then watched, as then I went on Instagram, and I follow the, I like to follow everyone, right? Like to see what everyone's saying. I like to follow the mainstream media for this reason, so I can have examples like this.
Yes.
I then watched the New York Times on Instagram post an applauding post to NBC and CBS and ABC for cutting away from the president while he was speaking, saying good job to these networks. What Donald Trump is saying is dangerous about counting illegal votes, like blah, blah, blah. Right. I'm sitting there watching all of this, and in my mind, the only thing I can think is that I am watching the New York Times applaud the major broadcasting systems, networks, for censorship.
Yes. Yeah.
They are like, I don't necessarily agree with what Donald Trump is saying. Maybe what he's saying about voter fraud is dangerous, like whatever. But you are denying the people, the masses, the public, access to make up their own fucking minds. Because that's what it is. Because you have the control over how we get broadcasted what the president is saying. And you're saying, we don't like what he's saying, so we're going to cut away from it so you can't even hear what your own president has to say.
Yes.
That's the world we live in.
That's the world we live in.
Mm-hmm. So it's only a matter of time before people like me and you, like it already has happened, get dragged. You know, the censor, you know, I will be so proud of this podcast when we get shadow banned.
High five.
Let's do it as fast as possible, right? Because that means that we're making noise.
Oh, man. What a world we live in. where censorship is a thing and has always been, but it's a lot more in our faces right now.
It's
like, it's clearly, I can clearly see it, like, yeah, exactly with your story. Mm-hmm. Clearly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It, to me, you know, and I recognize that I have privilege, mm-hmm, because I come from a family that has been able to financially support me. And I've been given the opportunity, and I've created some of, you know, I've created it for myself as well. But I've had that, you know, I don't have, you know, a bunch of kids that I have to feed. I don't have to work 3 jobs. You know, if I had to do all of that, pardon me, everyone. Allie Albini is texting me. Oh, how long till Allie can come be on our podcast? We're going to talk about plants.
Right? Plant mamas.
Plant mamas. You know, so, excuse me, you know, I got distracted about plant mamas.
Oh, God, now I'm thinking about plants.
I know. Let's talk about plants.
Which seems so opposite to what we're talking about right now.
But somehow it links. We have to cut the dead leaves and sacrifice and trim all the way back, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. So, okay, I caught it. So privilege. Yeah, privilege, right? Where it's like, I've had the opportunity of time, the privilege of time, right? And the privilege of money to be able to explore what I really perceive as what's happening in our world and the truth of it, you know? But so because of that, to me, when I look at our world and I look at what's happened in 2020, it's painfully obvious to me what's happening. And I need to soften a little bit because I need to recognize that not everyone has had the motivation, not everyone has had the opportunity that I have to have been awake for so long. And I think that's the point of what we're doing.
Yeah. It's an opportunity, really, to just have open conversations in a way where I'm not gonna call you an idiot.
Yes.
Like, that is the point.
Right.
Why are we calling each other idiots? Well, we're not.
Right.
that's all I've been seeing. You can't have a conversation with someone online because guaranteed, there's going to be some name calling. There's going to be some dragging in the streets.
Yeah.
What's the point?
God forbid you have a different perspective than the mainstream narrative. We talk about this, right? So I'm going to speak for both of us again, right? Crystal and I are pretty staunchly anti-mask, you know? We have both agreed that it's not the hill we want to die on, right? So, because really, you know, other people who we know who are anti-mask can be a little bit like, you know, some of the podcast people who we love to follow and authors are like, if you wear a mask, like, it's a sign of submission, right? And so don't wear that ass diaper on your face, right? Which is just funny, right? But what Crystal and I have also both experienced is that, so if we go into a small restaurant or if we go into our local grocery store and we're not wearing a mask, we're not sticking it to the man.
Yeah.
We're potentially getting that restaurant or that grocery store or, you know, whoever into trouble. And that's not who we want to stick it to, you know.
Yes.
You know, but so if we look at masks and we look at, you know, what's happened in our world, it's kind of painful.
It's very painful.
Because I see it, you know, I kind of, you know, Crystal and I, we're going to have that friend of yours on our podcast. I haven't met her yet, but I have
Melissa.
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 Melissa, we are calling you. So we both have these face mask exemption cards that are laminated and it talks about our First and Fourth Amendment rights, freedom of religion and freedom of property. Your person, your personhood is your freedom of, is your property, right?
Yes.
So the, you know, forced mandate of wearing masks is illegal. But, you know, it's painful because, so I kind of test the waters. Like, if I'm going to, like, a local store or something, I wear my mask because that's not who I want to stick it to. But I had to go to the mall, right? Or if I, you know, I don't wear a mask. And it's painful because people look at my healthy face, my smiling, optimistic, healthy face, and they see a threat. Mm-hmm. And people look at me with a death glare, mm-hmm. because I'm not wearing a mask. And somehow in our world, if you're not, you know, adopted the mainstream narrative about masks, then you want to kill everyone's grandma. You are an evil person, mm-hmm. who does not care about others because you're not wearing a mask.
Yeah. Yeah.
You had that story about the playground.
Yeah. Yeah, but even so, with that story, and even just children. So my children do not wear masks. Mm. It is not very often for us to find other children out in the world who are also breathing freely. Which, you know, I've been talking with my kids about that and how they're feeling about that. Because at first I was like, you're not wearing a mask. You are going to breathe air. Mm-hmm. But I almost forgot about how that makes them feel in the world, mm. to be the children in the store, yeah. when all they see are other children wearing masks. So it's almost, it's exactly how I would feel maskless in a store with masked people.
Yeah. Different.
Yeah.
Different.
And it just, it's sad. It's painful. Yeah. It's painful. That's what it is. It's just painful. And, you know, it's not like I've told my kids, hey, like, we're judging these other people. It's what I've been telling my kids is, this is our choice. Our choice. If we feel, if we, whatever, we can wear a mask. But if we feel another way, we should also not have to wear a mask. And that should be for everything. But I feel like this is the first time in history, which maybe it's not, but I'm just perceiving it as us not having that choice. And it's in our face every day.
Literally.
Like for homeschooling, I could go home and not have to worry about that. Mm-hmm. But this is such a huge problem. Mm-hmm. It's such a huge problem. Mm-hmm. It's painful.
Yeah, and let alone, you know, there's, I can't remember where I was hearing this. I don't have a triple blind study, everyone. But I was hearing about, you know, for me, it's like, honestly, like when I do wear a mask, it's hard to breathe. Mm-hmm. After a while, right? And so, like, my hat goes off to, like, you know, surgeons who wear masks for, like, 12-hour-long surgeries, because it's not easy to breathe, you know? Mm-hmm. And that's an example of where I see the benefit of a mask, when you have an open body in front of you. Like, that makes sense to me, right?
Yes.
But, you know, I've noticed that it's challenging to breathe. And so I can't remember where I was hearing this, but it was about, especially for young bodies that are still developing and these kids that are in school, you know, I have heard that, like, kids can sit at their desk without masks on, you know, but like kids that are wearing masks for hours and hours and hours at a time, like what that's doing to their brain development.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And this is an example of like a gut feeling again. Like, I can't go find the triple blind study about how masks are damaging to children's brain development, but my gut is telling me, let alone the psychological effects of having to be masked.
For real. Like, children need to see, like, when babies are born, they look to faces for emotions. Okay, I can't tell you. I'm not hating on anyone, but I'm just imagining being that baby and seeing someone, no one's, just not seeing a face.
Yeah.
That's creepy. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so, I mean, I've seen people talk about this, but it's just not talked about enough. Because these pediatricians, like, this is what's fishy. Where are the pediatricians? Where are the child psychologists, the developmentalness, talking about our children growing up just seeing in adults in masks? Mm-hmm. That's damaging. Mm-hmm. And to me, that's fishy. We can go every which way after that as to why. Right. But It's not okay.
It doesn't smell right, and our gut is having a reaction that's saying yes. Something doesn't smell right.
Yes.
And it's, you know, if we look at it, and I don't know the average numbers in a year, but through my own experiences this year, and also, you know, there have been more suicides than deaths from coronavirus this year. More people have died of suicide, and let's throw domestic violence in there too. More people have died from suicide and domestic violence than coronavirus. I don't know what the average numbers are of suicide per year, but I know that they're way fucking up this year, right? Like, they are skyrocketing, you know. They're skyrocketing. Domestic violence is skyrocketing. So, you know, I'm not here to say, you know, a lot of times what I feel like too in the conspiracy world, this is important. I'm glad this is coming out.
Good.
So like, I feel like too in the conspiracy world, it's like if you start to poke holes in something, then, you know, because people say, like, oh, like we faked the moon landing. So, you know, I grew up a couple minutes away from Sandy Hook, right? Which is the infamous, you know, slaughter of children, right? That happened, I think it was 14 kids, I can't quite remember, number of years ago. And so if you start to poke holes in that story and say, like, hey, like, I don't think that what the mainstream media is reporting is totally accurate, then I find that what people think you're saying is that it didn't happen.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
And it's like, that's not, like, I'm not saying that this didn't happen. I'm not saying that coronavirus isn't real. But what I am saying is that I think that the story that we're being told about why it happened, who did it, who's benefiting from it, right? Like, I don't think, you know, and the question for me that always gets asked is when an event like this happens, who's benefiting?
Yes.
After Sandy Hook, gun laws got super strict.
Oh, yeah. Right? And there were other school shootings.
Yes.
In a small amount of time.
Yes. Who benefits? Right? 9/11. Who benefited from that? Well, we got to go invade the rest of the Middle East, right? We got to have, after 9/11, 9/11 was brilliant. Do you know what got to happen after 9/11? They got to invade the entire rest of the Middle East.
Ooh.
And get the public's consent for mass surveillance against its own people, right? So it's like you have to look at who benefits, right? And so if we're looking at coronavirus and the lockdowns and the quarantines, who's benefiting? Big businesses.
Mm-hmm.
Big businesses are benefiting.
Mm-hmm. And it's like you have to ask yourself, why is that a secret?
Hallelujah. So that's the other thing. And we... I feel like we could just go forever. I feel like we should, like...
How far are
we? We've been talking for, like, 50 minutes.
Good.
Yeah, I know. Maybe we should, like, start to wrap this one up. Because that's... We keep saying, we're like, we don't have to say everything in the first episode. But you guys, we have so much that we want to talk about. Well, okay, let's see where this little thought train... Should we just let it die? Should we just...
No, finish your thought train.
Okay, I forgot it. No, okay, I can catch it. No.
Yeah. It was so good.
Yeah, who's benefiting?
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Let's see if it comes back. Oh, let's follow our gut. Yeah, who's benefiting?
Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's all about... It's so messy. It's just messy. Like the secret. The secret of it.
Thank you. You brought me back to the point. It's okay. The secrecy. And that's the thing, right? So one of our friends who I talk about this with a lot, Sarah Corman, she'll be on the podcast. We're very excited.
Sarah Corman.
Calling Sarah Corman to the principal's office. Let's get down to business. Okay, so, you know, one of the things that Sarah and I have talked about quite a lot is that, like, there is, like, a natural evolution in our world. There is a natural evolution. We live in the age of Aquarius. Like, there is a natural evolution toward humanity and technology merging.
Mm-hmm.
So that, you know, in a generation from now, like, our kids will all have Google in their third eye, you know?
Oh, God,
like,
I know. That's awful.
Okay, but, like, is it, though? Because, you know, if it's... Because here's the thing, right? Like, I think that there is... Like, I can imagine, if I poke into my third eye and I imagine a futuristic utopian society, like, I can imagine, you know, a world in which you click a button and the herbs that you want from China are just, you know, on a...
On an airstream. Yeah, on like a conveyor belt. Yeah, exactly. Like a wormhole, yeah. Right?
And how that would reduce pollution and what, you know, like I can imagine that world and I can imagine our children's brains that, you know, are already obviously a computer being more merged with technology for, you know, more humanitarian efforts, you know, into, you know, whatever. I can imagine this utopia of human and technology merging more. But the reason why I think that we're headed towards a dystopia, right? A dystopian future is because all of the Agenda 2030, right? And all that the New World is putting into order. That is, you know, if we look into the vaccines, my biggest fear about the vaccine is that Bill Gates is putting microchips in all of us to just track us even more, right? There is a natural thing that's happening that I think is being done deliberately and surreptitiously where, you know, oh, are you surprised that your iPhone has been recording you the whole time it's been in the pocket? It's like these news stories come out and it's like, yeah, no fucking shit.
Yeah,
you know?
For real.
But it's like, why was that a secret?
Yeah.
Why was that done in secret?
Yeah.
So it's like, for me, there is a natural order of things that's happening. The merging of human and technology to create the next step in evolution. But the reason why I'm fearful of it is because what I see is being done in secret. And that's why I think that we're being headed towards. Things are not, it's being, and here's the biggest thing. It's being done without consent.
Mm-hmm.
It's being done without consent.
And it needs to be brought to the light.
Yeah. And yeah. It will be brought to the light one way or another.
Of course.
It has to be. That's just the way of the universe, mm-hmm. you know. But my hope is that the work that we're doing in out, you know, your individual life and my individual life and our collaborative projects and this podcast and whatever else that we're doing is hopefully bringing things into the light so that we can usher in a utopia. But then, you know, the way of the world, then ultimately there will be another dystopia 10,000 years from now. Like, it's just the way of the universe, right? We just live in this episode of Earth.
Oh, it's the journey of the spiral. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
It's always been this way.
Yeah.
It will always be this way.
Mm-hmm.
And the only question is, who do we want to be in the story?
Yes.
We want to be empathetic. And we want to tell the truth.
Yes. Feel the truth, speak the truth.
Mm-hmm. Conversations of the times.
Woo-hoo.
So we wanted to finish today with a quote that, you know, Crystal and I read this quote a couple weeks ago and it initially sparked the conversation about the podcast. So we want to share this quote with you. It's by Zen Gardner and it launched a conversation for us that launched us into this podcast. And we're really excited to go on journey with each other and... with you.
Woohoo! Oh my gosh, exciting.
Okay.